Annie, and it's nice to meet everybody. I appreciate that introduction. As Jenny mentioned, I'm new to the team, and this will be my first Colorado Gives Day. So I'm very excited for that and really excited to showcase some of the changes that we've made this year in preparation for our big day on December 7th. So I'm just gonna jump right into it. Just to let everybody know, we are really excited for this year. Our 2021 incentive fund has grown from $1 million to almost $1.6 million, with the help of the sponsors that you see listed here on this page. So really excited by the support that we've been getting from our corporations and the local community. Just to give you a little bit of history before we kind of jump into where we are today, just want to remind everybody of where we've been, especially for folks that are new. So back in 2010 was the first Colorado Gives Day, and that's where we raised $8.4 million. 10 years later, right, we've reached 2020, we had a pandemic, and the community stepped up and drove over $50 million within that 24 hours of giving, which is absolutely incredible. This year for 2021, we've set our goal at $45 million, just because we didn't know sort of where the environment was going to be, how people were thinking in terms of giving. So while our goal seems low, we're actually secretly striving to beat last year. So all the help that we can get in that space collectively as a group, I think will be fantastic, and I'm really hopeful that we'll achieve beyond that. Just a couple of quick reminders before we get into all the goods. We are just 2 weeks away from November 1st, which is when scheduled donations kick off. So really excited for that and our kickoff with all the nonprofits. So we have a virtual event that we'll be doing on the November 1st as well. November 19th is the last day that profiles will be approved. So make sure to get those in. November 30th, of course, is Giving Tuesday, a great chance to let donors and others know that they can actually schedule their donations for Gives Day on Giving Tuesday. December 3rd is the last day to approve fundraising pages. And then, of course, December 7th is our big day for Colorado Gives. December 31st is when disbursements for the money that's raised during Colorado Gives Day get sent out. And then by January 25th is when the remaining funds for December get awarded. So those are some key dates to keep in mind. And we'll send out this presentation so you have access to all that and don't need to, you know, scurry and take some notes. So let's get into the meat of it. So we had an outside user experience group that did some user testing on our website. And we asked them to help us figure out what went well and where there could be areas of opportunities, where people were struggling. And what I'm going to say is that there are a lot of things that were done really well, but there are a couple of things that I wanted to share with you today around opportunity areas and how we went about to address those. So first, we're going to take a look at the nonprofit landing page. So this is what the page looked like prior to the change that we rolled out on September 13th. And there were four key opportunity areas that were brought to our attention. The first is that when people landed on this page, the first thing that they noticed as the primary call to action was start a fundraiser versus the donate button. The second thing that came to our attention was that users expected to see more information about the nonprofit's program versus just general contact information. The third is when users clicked on the more information link that appeared towards the top of the page, it immediately dropped them down to the bottom part of the page, and they were sort of confused as to where they were in the process. And then the last thing that came to our attention was that the font size was actually small for some of our audience, right? They wanted a bigger font size to be able to see things more clearly. Well, some of the changes that we then implemented, you can see sort of the new style on the right-hand side. What we did is we actually incorporated the donation module straight onto the page versus having it be a separate call to action that drove to another step. So we're eliminating steps in the process for the donor and drawing more attention to it as the primary call to action. The second thing that we did based on the feedback is we actually increased the font size, so it's a bit more readable for our primary audience. The third thing, we talked about that Learn More link, Well, when you click on it now, there's some animation and it slowly brings you down the page. So you have context as to where you are. And then finally, you can see down at the bottom, the start a fundraiser is the secondary call to action on this page that captures your attention. So if a donor is at the point where they're doing some research and not quite at the stage that they want to make a donation, but really want to start a movement for your nonprofit, they can easily come here and start that process. Some of the challenges that we heard about in the current donation flow was that you can see on the right-hand side, this is what the old page looked like, that there was a lot of fields to fill out. And you can see that here, radio buttons and dropdowns in the page scrolled and scrolled. And there was confusion when we had asked people, where do you want to direct your donation? And there was only one item listed in the dropdown. Typically, people would expect if there's a dropdown that there's multiple selections. The third thing that we heard is when we asked people if they wanted to cover the fee, we simply asked, do you want to cover it? Yes or no. But we didn't actually tell them how much the fee was. Is it 50 cents? Is it $2? Is it $10? And so that was a point of confusion at this point in the process. The fourth thing that the users told us is when they went to go select the anonymous selection, that they were confused. They weren't sure what all the various options meant, and it sort of halted them in their process. When you hover over tooltips, the feedback we got from users was, that's a lot of content, and that's a lot to read. Item number six that came up on this flow was, I'm a proud employee of. People thought, oh, all the companies that are out there would be listed there, and they weren't. So they were kind of confused as to, well, what happens when I select that? Where does that information go? What does it do? And then lastly, while this wasn't perceived as a negative comment by all the users, a couple of people mentioned that the call to actions like add to cart and checkout made Colorado Gives feel like an e-commerce site. So not a negative thing, but a comment that some people had made. So what did we do with this information? This is a lot of feedback. So what we did is we completely reimagined what that donation flow looked like. And what we did is we've made improvements where we've put the donation into a mobile-friendly sized donation module. And for the majority of users that are making a one-time donation, they're only going to go through two steps versus that long list of questions that they would need to answer. So they come here to input their dollar amount, and then they tell us whether or not they want to cover the fee. Now, donors have the option to further customize their donations. So if you want to make it in honor of memory or to be anonymous, those options are still there. The third item that we addressed, as you can see, is the processing fee. We're actually doing that math and calculating it for the user so that they see how much it is. And we're defaulting to that they'll cover the fee, since that's what the majority of people will do. Number four is we've retained the optional items that are set up within the backend for each of the nonprofits. So if you want to entice donors to sign up for your mailing list or your email list, that will appear here on this screen as well. And then finally, we did take that feedback around, well, it feels too e-commerce-y, and we've softened the language a bit to have them add to basket. And so we're calling the add to cart, add to basket. And when you get into the checkout flow, it's called your giving basket. So a little bit of a softer language that has tested really well. Now, when you go through the donation module, there's a couple of different types of displays. As some of you may have, there is donation levels that have labels associated to them. So this is an option within the admin tool that you have access to be able to designate donation levels. You can choose not to, and when you choose not to, it'll just be a dollar entry field that the donor can type in. But if you have the labels with the dollar amounts, they'll appear like this. But wait, we're giving you a third option should you choose to want to use it, which is the ability to set donation amounts without labels. So we want to be able to give you the flexibility to present these donation levels in the way that you think would work for your donors. So just as a reminder, you have three options. One is a simple entry field. Number two is the dollar amounts with labels. And now number three is these dollar amounts with no labels. Now, how do you go about actually setting this? So I'm going to show you a couple of instructional slides. And again, we'll send this out so you have access to it to be able to walk through at your leisure. And of course, we are here to help you in case you have any questions along the way. But I'll show you how to do that in the back end. So these are the instructions. If you want to set donation levels with no labels, so it's that this display over here that you see, what you'll do is you'll log into your portal. You're going to go to donation information, click on the donation form tab, and you'll see something that looks like this. You'll want to select no labels, and then you will be required to enter up to 6 records. They should all be above the $5 amount, since that's the minimum that we ask donors to give on the website. And what I would recommend is that you list them in the sequential order, since that's how it will appear on the website. So it makes more sense if you do 25, 50, 75. I would not recommend doing 50, 75, 25. It'll just look confusing to the user. So do it in the way in which it'll display on the website. And then to change those dollar amounts, if that's something that you want to do, you'll be able to click modify levels and you can make those changes easy peasy. Now, if you want to actually add donation levels with labels, same area of the website that you're going to go to, but this time you're going to click on use labels. And when you do that, you can then edit the labels and they'll appear here. Again, that'll appear in the order on the website. And then you'll just want to make sure that it's selected to show. And if for any reason you want to edit that, simple edit buttons are here to update those labels. If you're in the group where you say, I don't want any labels, I don't want any dollar amounts, I want to just have it be blank. Well, here's how you can do that. Same location on the donation information tab and going to the donation form. But this time you can just click remove levels. That'll remove the levels altogether. If you already have those donation levels set, you can just simply click delete and it'll remove those. So those are some simple instructions on how to set your donation levels on your module. Now I want to go into a little bit around what donors can do on this donation module to really customize their donation, should they want to, but they don't have to. These are all optional items. So the first thing that we're going to talk about is if somebody wants to direct their donation to a program. Fun fact here, because I love data, so you will see me use data throughout. Only 5% of donors last year chose a program to direct their funds. So that's why we made these sort of secondary items within the flow, because not as many people use them. But we didn't want to get rid of it because we knew it was still important. Now, if you have a program set up for your particular nonprofit that displays within the flow, it will always default to where it's needed most. This is where it's your discretion on how those funds get used, but you're able to set various programs that a donor can choose from. And if you do that, it'll display here as a link on the donation module. And when they click it, they're going to see a screen where they can select the dropdown and choose one of those programs. As I mentioned, if you don't have any of those programs selected, this link will not appear for the user. So we're only displaying it if the information exists. We still have the option for donors to provide special instructions or comments that will be sent to you when they make that donation. Now, if, say, for instance, you don't have any programs, what will still display in its place is leave a comment for the nonprofit. So about 7% of donors actually did this last year. So this is their way to be able to send you messages of gratitude or instructions. We've seen when we've looked at special instructions that this is where donors can say, hey, we love the amazing work that you do, and we like to be able to give them a spot to be able to do that. Okay, donate anonymously. As you may have remembered from what I had said in terms of the challenges, people were kind of confused as to what each of the options meant. And so what we did is we provided a simple explanation. When somebody clicks on donate anonymously, we provide them 3 options. Number 1 is to be anonymous in publications. where their information will be shared with the nonprofit, but that they don't want it to be listed in any sort of public reports. Option number two is to donate completely anonymously. Now, we have some dynamic language in here for those that have the Colorado State Tax Credit, where if somebody selects us, we tell them, hey, the nonprofit's not going to know who you are and you're not going to be able to get a tax credit. So we want to be upfront with that information. And then, of course, we always want to give them the option to share their information with us so that they can, so that we can communicate to them. Now, in a typical flow, if somebody does not click on donate anonymously, they don't interact with it, all their information will be shared with you. I find it quite fascinating when I looked at the data. I thought, well, of all the things, if somebody chose to be anonymous, I would have bet my dollar on the fact that people would have chose to be completely anonymous. Well, I was wrong. The data showed that actually 17% of our 2020 donations were anonymous in publication, only compared to 8% who chose to be anonymous. So I thought that that was fascinating, which is one of the reasons why we're defaulting to anonymous in publication, since it seems like the majority of users are selecting that. Now, in honor or memory is the other customization that donors can make while they're making their donation. Fun fact here, 11% of our donors actually chose to make a donation in honor or memory of someone. What we've done here is when somebody clicks on that link, we wanted to have some more conversational language versus just first name and last name. So we have labels assigned here as in honor of whom or who is making the tribute. So it feels a bit more conversational and less sort of e-commerce-y. Now, with this change, our donation reports are going to update to show the tribute name versus just first name and last name. So that's just more a heads up. As you pull your report, you'll see that change take place. And then lastly, donors can still request to have their tribute, the person being tributed, notified via email or mail. So those two options still continue to exist today. Now, what about recurring donations? So we just talked through all of the options that are there for a donor to customize, but they can also choose to do a one-time donation or a recurring donation. We've made a change here. We used to offer weekly, monthly, quarterly, annually, and other. We gave five options to users in the past, because 96% of the reoccurring donations happen monthly and yearly, we've narrowed those options down to those two. So when someone selects recurring, they'll be able to choose monthly, annually, and it'll default to the first donation date will be today's date. Again, trying to do some defaulting so donors don't have to put in as much effort. They can just validate, yep, I want to make that reoccurring donation start today. They'll still have the option to customize when they want their donation to end. So ongoing with no end date, after a specific date or dollar amounts or number of payments. So we've retained all of that customization that the donor can choose. Now, when it comes to scheduling for Gives Day, the process is going to look just slightly different. So as you know, November 1st, which is 2 weeks away, it's coming up so quickly and we're very excited for it, our donors can start to schedule their donation for Gives Day. And we wanted to make sure that the calls to action were very apparent to them. And so when this donation module will update, so they have the option to schedule for Gives Day or schedule your donation for today. So you'll see on November 1st that this donation module will have a slight change in the user interface. And of course, we'll also be able to display if you have a goal set up for Gives Day, how many days are left, how you're tracking in terms of scheduled donations towards that goal can be displayed on the nonprofit landing page. So we're excited for that. Other changes that we've made, because, you know, we're just not going to stop there. We're going to take it all the way through the cart and into checkout. So when we talk to users about the cart through checkout experience, we ask them, well, what are some of the challenges? There were four big challenges that rose up. The first is when users went through the cart and they clicked on the call to action that said, enter your payment information. the page sort of refreshed and they didn't know what happened. They didn't know that they had to scroll down the page to be able to see all of the payment information that they had to enter. So that was a big hurdle. The second hurdle was we had a field called promo code. And they thought, huh, do I get a discount on my donation? What does that mean exactly? The third was that some users had expressed that we had a secondary call to action to add more donations. And they thought, well, I've already added all my donations. I don't need to add another one. So we've gotten some feedback on having that be as prominent as a call to action. And then lastly, and I would say the biggest challenge that our users faced was the spacing on our form fields. Just simply having the label not close enough to the form field caused a lot of confusion, and people actually filled it out wrong, and they'd had to redo the entire process. So that caused a lot of friction for the users. And the good news is some of that stuff is very simple changes to make, and we did them. We rolled out these cart changes on August 31st, and here are the major improvements that we made. We reduced a lot of the copy that was on the page because it was a lot to read, paragraphs of text. Number two is that we actually made very distinct process steps. And you'll notice this when any of you work on, like go to a consumer site, it'll tell you you're on your cart, now you're on your personal information page, and now you're on payment. So three very clear, distinct steps so they knew where they were. The third thing is that we're informing users when they log in if they actually had donations saved from a previous session. How many of us have started something on your mobile device and then went over to your laptop to go finish it? And it's like, oh, right, yeah, thanks, Holly, I see you waving. Absolutely, I do that all the time. The nice thing is when you log into the website, it recognizes, hey, you did something on your mobile device and we just wanna tell you those things are now in your cart. So we're retaining that information and making it very clear to users. The fourth improvement that we made in that same regard regarding notifications to donors is that if they accidentally put duplicate items in their cart. So this has happened because Jenny has gotten phone calls related to it of, oh, I only meant to give $100 and I accidentally had it twice in my cart. We have a pop-up notification that tells them, hey, it appears that you have duplicate items in your cart. Please validate before you continue through the process. So hopefully that'll help reduce those types of issues going forward. And then lastly, we did modify that promo code field to a donation code and provided instructional copy. We have a little info link that tells people, hey, this is something that's rarely used, but it's something that we leverage with corporate employers to do employee matching. So it's a lot more clear to those users as to what the donation code is all about. And I'm happy to announce that all of those changes that we made through the cart, through the checkout, we've seen a 25% improvement in conversion rate, meaning more people are making it through the checkout flow and getting donations in your hands. So we are so unbelievably excited for that. So what do we need from you? What can we do with this great information? I would say a couple of things. Number one is check to see if you have donation levels set up in your profile. If you do, make sure that they're listed in the order in which you want them appear on the site in sequential order. So it's recognizable, right, to donors. They understand what that means and it doesn't look confusing. Number three is feel free to add or remove the donation level labels. We've seen folks use it in a way to describe, hey, this is what that money is going to go towards and sort of the impact that it has. Maybe $100 feeds a family of four for a week, right? Like that gives people a sense of the impact that their money is going to have. I would say also to take a look at the content on the website, right? We're approaching scheduled donations, we're approaching Gives Day, and the best thing to do is be able to communicate to the donors what your purpose and your mission is all about and the impact that you're having. So take a look at your photos and videos. Make sure that your description really illustrates to donors the impact that you have. And finally, I would really encourage everyone, get out there on the site, play with the donation flow, make a donation to yourself. Either you could do it today or even do it and or do it on November 1st when scheduled donations. That way you have a sense of what the experience is like for your donors. So with that said, that was a lot of talking from me. I want to be able to open it up to questions. What questions does this group have that I might be able to answer?
Erica, that was great information. I was really excited to see it. We had a question in the chat that I didn't know the answer to. What is the average percent of people that choose recurring donations on our site?
Oh, great question. So I've been knee deep in all of this data. Typically what we have seen is about 2% of all of donations are recurring. Since we did this change, it actually has increased to 4%. It's only been live for about a month now. So the results are still preliminary, right? We want to be able to get more days under us, but so far so good in terms of increasing those recurring donations.
Great. Hi, Amber. To your question about IndieGives. So while we are not direct partners with IndieGives, most IndieGives nonprofits are on Colorado Gives as well. And so it's very much a symbiotic relationship with the folks down in the Springs.
There was a question in the chat, and maybe Jenny answered it, but maybe you could just share it for everybody. If they choose to join an electronic mailing list, how do they get that information?
So, great question. When a donor chooses that they want to join your email list, you have a column for that on your donor report. Donor reports export as a CSV, so easy to manipulate and format for your needs for sure. And so you'll see it on your donor report. There's a cheat sheet for your donor report listed on the donation information tab on the default. So I suggest taking a look at it so that you know where to find things in a quick and easy manner. Erica, do you know the percent of scheduled donations?
Oh, I feel like I'm getting quizzed, which is good. I don't know off the top of my head, but it's a great question. I do have the data. So maybe Jenny, if we can take this note down and when we send out the presentation, I can include that data.
Okay. Kathy?
I will say, as I'm picturing the graph in my head that appears in my email that has this data, we absolutely see that there are spikes in terms of scheduled donations that happen. One is on Giving Tuesday, and then the second is like right before we ramp into Gives Day itself. So we'll see spikes within the scheduled donations. One of the things that I think, Cindy, you might have posted within the chat itself, but I think awesome to share with the larger group as a whole, is starting on November 1st, we do have prizes and incentives. So really encourage your donors to get out there to schedule their donation early, because you will then be entered to win, I believe it's $2,000 every week. There's 5 weeks that we're going to be running it for. So if you get donors to get scheduled donations for your nonprofit, you're entered to win. So get out there, get them to schedule, and keep pushing that message. Because if you win in week one, you're absolutely eligible to win in week two. So really great message to push out there.
I love that. Thanks so much. Kathy had a great question in chat. So first year for Kathy's folks, and what percentage of organizations get donations in their first year? So I don't actually know the percentage, Kathy, but I'll tell you that last year we had 2,875 nonprofits on the site, and 2,864 of them got a donation. So I'd say that what I call this is the program works if you work it. We've got your back, right? We are hugely invested in our media, in our plans, in our toolkits. And if you ride the wave, it is very, very easy to get your donors involved in Colorado Gives and Colorado Gives Day. And if you have any ideas or you have any needs, we sure would love to hear from you. Absolutely. Holly, yes. So if somebody chooses that they want to have a mailed letter for their in honor or in memory, that is up to the nonprofit themselves. So we are not sending out direct mail. Best practices. Okay, so my favorite thing to do with donor matches is to set up a fundraising page that is directly for the match. And even if it's anonymous, Tamara, you have the ability to direct content, and then you can have a goal for the match. So the match is 10,000, you can set the goal for 10,000. You can have people that are driven to this match page, and you just make it all about what the match's impact is going to make, as opposed to here's secret, you know, admirer number one. You can put it in there, but make sure that you talk impact, 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 and you drive your people there. If you have questions about how to set up fundraising pages and how to make that happen, I'm absolutely happy to help. You can catch me offline, and I'll put my email into the chat as well.
I'd also second that, Jenny, but I would also take it another level to super campaigns, because when you have these multiple people with fundraising pages, it kind of makes that bigger goal more attainable, or more, I don't want to say more attainable necessarily, but more appealing. And then you can really get that match unlocked, if that's how the terms from the donor is. But yeah, super campaigns come from fundraising pages. So you need two fundraising pages, and you can have a super campaign. You'll have a landing page that shows all of your efforts in that.
Yep, and get entered into the super campaign prize. So nice little sweet plug from Jaime on that. So the super campaign prize is random prize this year, and it's nice and chunky under the Get Engaged Prizes link that Cindy has shared. There are $7,000 grants going out for these super campaigns, you guys, and there's tons of information that's available. On your nonprofit dashboard is the link to the Get Engaged campaign that has a step-by-step walkthrough on building fundraising pages, getting people involved, building the super campaign. And of course, my offer is to anyone who is trying to get these set up. I've been doing little Zooms, right? We share screens, we get them together. So let me know if you need that. Happy to help with that. Hi, Kathy. Yes. So all donations, no matter how they are collected, if that is through your nonprofit page, your fundraiser page, they linked through a super campaign, they came through Kids Give. All donations that are made that are counted towards Colorado Gives Day count towards your goal, the incentive fund, and your entries into any prizes that they're attached to. I feel like I missed a question somewhere, Cindy.
You got it, and I'll answer it. Chris was wondering if are we allowed to run a Facebook ad for Colorado Gives? Yes, you are. But it's important that you realize we also have over $2.5 million worth of advertising and promotional efforts, thanks to our media sponsors. So there's a large statewide campaign that's really kicking off November 1st. But if you want to do some boosted social ads for your organization or in your region of the state, go for it. You can use any of the art in the toolkit. You don't have to ask for permission. The toolkit is there for you to make it easy for you to promote the event as much as you can. We'd love to see the help.
And Cindy, that goes for like the requests we've been getting, right? When people want to use a graphic in their newsletter, they want to put it out with their media sponsors, we're kosher with that, right?
Absolutely. And we encourage you to co-brand. So this year we have lots of transparent images that you can use in Canva, a free online graphic design tool. If you don't have a designer, just download those transparent images, lay them over the top of your photo of you in action. So co-branding is absolutely encouraged.
One other thing that I'd love to toss out there just to make the group aware of, in case you're interested to share this within the next couple of weeks. I'm going to share my screen very quickly, if that's okay. We are actually testing out some other new features on the website. We are allowing people to sign up for SMS text message reminders as to when Colorado Gives Day is. So if you're interested in supporting and sort of posting this effort out there, feel free to leverage the assets that Cindy just talked about, and you can direct them to the Colorado Gives homepage. There's a remind me button, or you can direct them straight to this landing page to sign up for text message reminders. And what will happen is on November 1st, we'll send out a message letting people know that they can start scheduling their donations. And then if they haven't made a donation between now and Gives Day, we'll send them that reminder on Gives Day as well, so they don't miss the opportunity.
Thanks, Cindy. So Cindy answered a question that was in chat about all the social media channels that we are going to be on. So we do have some really super exciting things coming. I'm not sure if this landed in the chat already, but I would like to plug our kickoff and the registration to our kickoff that is happening on November 1st. And I understand that there will be cookies. I heard something about cookies, so we'll see.
Cookie dough, candy canes, syrup. There's a hint.
I feel like we didn't do Thanksgiving yet. No, never a short day for cookies. That's what I have to say about that. Are there, for those who don't know, oh, thank you very much, Marilee. Marilee shared in a chat for Canva and mentioned how Canva is a free tool. You guys, Canva is awesome. I am totally not graphically literate and I can manage Canva. And so I would highly suggest that you get in and play with it. And I'd also like to mention that in our toolkit, there is a really helpful video from Jaime and Emma on some easy steps. So I'd just love to mention that as well. Are there any other questions, you guys? Quiet group today. Yay, kickoff registration in the chat. Well, if everybody is kind of settled, I feel like I could give us all 20 minutes back in our day. There, of course, will be a follow-up email that has this presentation, any unanswered data questions, and as well as information on the toolkits, the kickoff, all that kind of stuff. Kathy, Cindy has asked that you say more about the kickoff meeting.
Okay, everybody. So for people who've been part of Colorado Gives Day in the past, you may recall the rally down at the state capitol, but there's this little thing that entered our lives about 18 months ago called COVID. And since then, we did an online event last year. This year, we're doing another online event, and we're doing it for a couple different reasons. One, it gives people from all over the state the opportunity to participate, which warms our heart, because Colorado Gives Day, Colorado Gives, is a statewide platform. It's a statewide event, and it's not always possible for people to, you know, travel the roads in December to come down for an event that lasted a little over an hour. So we're doing it online. This year, we're really trying to celebrate you and all the hard work that you have done over the last year, getting ready for Colorado Gives Day, getting your profiles set up. So the rally will be held November 1st from 9 to 9:30 on Zoom. And we have some really fun guests who will be coming. We will have a special workshop from the Denver Center for the Performing Arts on inspiring your creativity and harnessing your energy. We have giveaways for some really entertaining packages that we're going to give away for people who attend. It's really going to be a celebration of you, the hard work you do every day, kicking off the Colorado Gives Day campaign, and just having fun. So we encourage you to join us. It's going to be a Zoom party.
Thanks, Cindy. I'm really excited about it, you guys. So I hope that all of you can join us for it. And I'm also super excited to not be standing on the Capitol steps at 8 degrees holding a sign pole. So I'm voting for that as well. Yay, Kathy, I'm so glad. We'll be really excited to see all of your faces.
And this is the kickoff is for our nonprofits. You guys can invite your staff, invite your board members. This is really a celebration for you also. It's a fun way to energize your team and really get them excited to schedule that donation and hit the door running. I mean, it's going to be great.
Right? Really exciting. Okay, guys, any last minute questions? So
Jaime had a good point. He posted a comment. These Zoom backgrounds that you see that I have here, I have the Western Slope. Erica has some pretty sunflowers. Jaime's got the Denver landscape. These are all in the toolkit. If you go download them from the toolkit, have them up when you attend the rally, there might be an extra prize that you can win. So it's also a really fun, subtle way to promote Colorado Gives Day and use them in all your meetings between now and December 7th.
Thanks, Cindy. Thanks, Jaime. That's a great idea. All right, folks. I feel like this is the third time now.
Okay. See, we just want to be together.
I know. All right, folks. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll be sending out the follow-ups and everything like that. Let us know if you've got questions. Contact CoGives. We're all here and available for you. I put all my fellow colleagues on the chopping block for this kind of stuff. So give us a call. Let us know what you need. And let us help you out so we can all have the best Colorado Gives Day ever. Thank you so much.